I'll call the regular meeting to order at 7:01 p.m. Governing board meetings are held in the boardroom at the Ben Furlong Education Center located at 8700 South Kyrene Road in Tempe. We regularly meet on the second and fourth Tuesdays of the month. However, there is only one board meeting in July and December. All meetings begin at 7 p.m. We welcome community involvement and encourage people to come to board meetings and be involved in our community. School board meetings are held in public to conduct the business of the district. These board meetings are broadcast on Tempe and Phoenix Cable Channel 99, Sundays between 6 to 8 a.m. and in Chandler, on Friday, Saturday, and Sunday at 6 p.m., Sunday at noon, and Tuesdays at 3. The Chandler broadcast will be aired the week following the board meeting. Tempe 11 on Cox Channel 11 now also airs our meetings three times a week on Tuesday evenings, Tuesday afternoons, and Sunday mornings. Specific times are available at their website, www.tempe.gov/Tempe11. Videos of board meetings are posted on the Kyrene website approximately 1 week after the meeting. Board agendas may be obtained from the district office Kyrene website 24 hours in advance of each board meeting. Our superintendent, David Schauer, Secretary Marriott, senior leadership, lead principals, directors, and interested citizens are here with us tonight. The first item is a moment of silence. I'll ask you to please stand, and then Ms. Brazell will lead us in the pledge. Thank you, Ms. Brazell. Next item is roll call. Will board members please state their name for the record?
Ross Robb.
Bernadette Coggins.
Ellen Shama.
Beth Brazell.
Michelle Hirsch. Let the record show all five board members are present. Next is approval of the minutes. The approval of the minutes for the study session for December 6, 2011. All board members may vote to approve these minutes. May I have a motion?
Move to approve the minutes of the regular meeting.
Second.
It's actually the study session of December 6th.
No.
Oh. Okay, I'm sorry, Mike.
Don't trick me.
Okay, thank you. So I got a motion and a second. All in favor, please say aye.
Aye.
Aye. Motion passes 5-0. And so then we'll approve the minutes of the study session. Now, is it December 6th?
13th.
Okay. So then this is the study session of December 13th. All board members may vote to approve these minutes. May I have a motion?
Move to approve the minutes from the study session December 13th.
Second.
Thank you. All in favor, please say aye.
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 Motion passes 5-0. Next is approval of the tonight's agenda. Are there any changes to this evening's agenda, including the consent agenda? May I have a motion to approve tonight's agenda?
Move to approve tonight's agenda as stated.
Second.
All in favor, please say aye.
Aye.
Aye. Motion passes 5-0. Next, we are at item 5.0, request to speak to the governing board. The 5.0 section is for items not listed on the agenda. Because 5.0 items are not on the agenda, the board is not able to respond to comments made during this section. When a request to speak is made, please note that you are addressing the governing board only. If you wish to speak to the governing board, please fill out one of the blue cards located on the table by the door and bring it to our secretary, Marriott. One blue card per agenda item, please. I have two blue cards for the 5.0 section. Out of respect for audience members and speakers, time will be limited to 3 minutes for up to 10 speakers before the regular business meeting, with the balance after the business portion. We will respond after, that's not that section. So, and Ms. Brazell will indicate to the speaker when there are 15 more seconds available, and then again when time is up. The first blue card is Jennifer Deering. Welcome.
Up there, right? Go. Good evening, board superintendent. Thank you for letting me come. I'm Jennifer Deering, president of the Arts Council for Youth. I'm going to take one of my minutes to quickly remind you who we are. We're a 501c3 nonprofit serving Kyrene and the Tempe Union High School districts. We host the Arts Teacher Reception in this very room. Thanks for helping. We co-sponsor the Damon Russell Fawcett Memorial Scholarship for Tempe grads to continue their art and music studies. We put on the annual Arts Jam, which last year we combined with you guys for the Kyrene Honors Music Festival at the absolutely fabulous Tempe Center for the Arts. This year, we don't have that big grant, and you guys don't have the time either, so we will be at Mountain Point Arts Jam and the Kyrene Band Festival, so I'll be seeing you again there. That, for the record, is Friday night, March 2nd. Did they just turn it up? 5 to 9 p.m. at Mountain Point High School. We also, in our free time, co-sponsor the Georgia Stewart Scholarship for Teachers. That's for teachers to support their own education. It's not for students. It is not limited to Kyrene teachers. It is not limited to Kyrene and Tempe teachers. It is for anywhere that the Stewart family is connected to public education. So it's close to national. And it's very hard to judge. We had more applicants than ever this year, but 2 years in a row, a Kyrene teacher won. It is also not only for arts teachers, but it went to Laura Motish, your arts teacher at Pueblo and Acumel. Her application started off with, I love my students, and it just got better from there. So people all over the country voted, and she won. So just wanted to support her and show her off to you guys. Thank you.
I don't know if there's much time left anyways, but I do want to just thank you, Jen, and thank the Arts Council. I'm going to be using this to take more art classes and focus on the artist part of the artist teacher in me. So thank you again for everything.
Congratulations. Next is Ken Brown. Will you come up?
Well, good evening, and thank you very much for allowing me to speak. I appreciate it. I live in the Kyrene District, and I have two children who have been through KMS and Corona, and it's been a while now. My oldest is now in college, so it's been a real while. And every once in a while, you know, we've been very fortunate in the district to have some teachers that really, really touch and can change children's lives. And I feel very fortunate to have run across this Julie Hackman at KMS, and I started volunteering for her probably about 8 years ago when my son was in choir there and in the musical theater programs. And as it turns out, I still volunteer today, even though I have no students anymore in KMS. And the interesting thing is there are other parents who I know there and I've known there for years who also still volunteer. And even when I was there, there were parents volunteering who had kids who had already graduated, and they're still volunteering. So, you know, we know when we find teachers like that, and obviously we're not volunteering for the money and the glory. We're doing it to support those amazing teachers. One of the ways I volunteer is I happen to take photos for choirs and drama programs and for some of the schools. I do it now for Corona del Sol. Once again, I don't have a student there anymore, but I still take pictures for them, again, because of some of the amazing teachers there. And I was shooting pictures for the winter choir concert in December. I happened to see Mrs. Hackman about earlier in the week of that concert, and she was kind of telling me about the kids, and, oh, they're not quite ready, and what are we going to do? And as usual, her students just pulled it off, because at the choir concert, they got up on stage, and they just were amazing. They just blew everybody away. And the very last piece in their set, all the stage lights went off, and you know, their kind of specialty is they do things with gloves and had to do some amazing things with vocal and with gloves. And all the lights went off and you're waiting to see what happens and all their gloves lit up. So it was dark except for their gloves. And I took that opportunity to shoot a photo and kind of a little bit of an abstract kind of photo, but I thought it would be a nice remembrance of Julie for her just amazing choir and amazing students. Uh-oh. And the things that she does for her students. I'll show that to you guys too. So I'd like to just present this to Julie and give it to her tonight. Maybe she can come up and to say thank you for everything that she does and also to let this board know just what an amazing teacher that you have at KMS. Thank you.
Thank you. Wow, those are two really fun blue cards. I know you'll be just as fun, Nancy. Nancy Branch.
Madam President, members of the board, Dr. Schauer, and members of the community, I just have to take a quick moment to agree with the last speaker that what an amazing place Kyrene is, filled with outstanding teachers, and I am honored to be here tonight as we recognize those who have gone through the National Board Certification. It is a lot of work, as you know, and we have a lot of people in this room that have worked very hard, and these are people that work hard each and every day as they come to our schools, caring deeply about children and working on their behalf, whatever it takes. So I'm just honored to be here tonight as we celebrate and recognize them, and had to give a special shout out to my former millennial peeps. Love you guys.
Thank you. And we are going to continue with the fun because item 6.01 is recognition of Melissa Melville, Centennial Middle School teacher, Dr. Schauer.
Thank you very much. We're really pleased to celebrate with Melissa tonight and to introduce her. I think Ev Michelle, who is her principal, will tell us a little bit about Melissa and the award that she won. So welcome. Glad you're here.
Thank you very much, Madam President, Dr. Schauer, members of the board and the community. I am so proud to be here to be able to recognize Melissa Melville. She is one of the most outstanding teachers that I've worked with, along with all of the other Kyrene teachers that we have in Kyrene. Melissa has been working at Centennial for 6 years. She taught eighth grade science her first year, and her last 5 years she's been teaching seventh grade science. She is also the science department chair. She facilitator for the district mentor network. She is a member of the science steering committee. She's also our STEM, our science, technology, engineering, math, after school program team leader. She is the technology site leader at our school. She also volunteers. We have a learning lab 4 days a week, and we have Saturday school at Centennial, and Melissa volunteers her time to be a part of those programs. And I'm very proud of her to be the NBC Learn, had identified Melissa as their December teacher using the NBC Learn videos that she brings to her real-world science connections to her classroom every day. She is the most hands-on science teacher, and she's always looking for wonderful things. So it's a great honor that I've been here to recognize Melissa.
Wow, thank you. Thank you for having me here tonight. It's a great honor and truly a surprise. I wasn't expecting this at all. The NBC videos, for those of you who don't know, they're just 2 to 3 minute short clips of the NBC News, and they can be found for any topic that you're studying in class. So I use them all throughout the week, maybe to get students excited about a lesson we're going to learn, or even as an assessment tool, but most importantly, to help students see the connections between the classroom science and the real world, which they sadly sometimes miss. But I'm just so thankful to be in a district that provides this tool to the teachers and the students. So thank you.
Thank you.
Are there any board member comments? Congratulations, and thanks for being here so that we could recognize you. Next is the 6.02 recognition of nationally board certified teachers. Dr. Schauer.
Thank you very much. We're excited to congratulate the nationally board certified teachers this year. And you know, as you might be able to tell, they're starting to take over our hallway here. They're all over the wall, and it's getting bigger and bigger every year, so we're really excited to celebrate with them tonight, and Mary Jane Rincon will be introducing them. So thanks for being here, Mary Jane.
Thank you. Madam President, members of the Governing Board, and Dr. Schauer, it's my distinct honor to be here tonight, along with five very proud principals, to introduce and recognize 9 amazing Kyrene teachers who recently obtained National Board Certification. I do want to note, as Dr. Schauer pointed out, because we do have so many pictures out there in the hallway, that Kyrene now has 39 active teachers in our classrooms who are nationally board certified. But before I turn this presentation over to the principals, who are going to tell you a little bit more about each of these individuals, I'd like to share a little bit more about the National Board Certification process. As you may know, National Board Certification is an advanced teaching credential. In a congressionally mandated study, National Board Certification was recognized by the National Research Council as having a positive impact on student achievement, teacher retention, and professional development. National Board Certification is a very rigorous program. The certification process is based on high standards that evaluate teaching practice through performance-based assessments. Teachers who achieve National Board Certification have met rigorous standards through intensive study, expert evaluation, self-assessment, and peer review. Teachers must successfully complete 4 portfolio-based written entries. 2 of these involve the teachers videotaping themselves as a part of defending their performance against the standards. So at this time, I'd like to ask the principals and the teachers to join me. They're going to introduce the individuals to you and tell you a little bit more about each of these amazing teachers.
Good evening. I have the pleasure tonight to introduce 5 newly recognized National Board Certified teachers. We had 8 teachers begin a cohort several years ago together at Millennio. And while 5 members of the cohort are here tonight to be recognized for achieving National Board Certification, the others have an exceptional attitude and know exactly what they need to do to revise and achieve their certification for next year. So we're very proud of that entire cohort. I'm very proud that so many of them worked so hard together. I'd first like to introduce Jocelyn Taylor, a fantastic teacher who has taught 8 years at Millennio in our Title I program and now is a first grade teacher. Mrs. Taylor sets high expectations for her students and staff, and she currently is our positive behavior team leader and runs our K-2 student recognition assemblies. When asked to describe her, her students describe her as nice, pretty, and smart. She teaches us good things. Millennio appreciates her for her enthusiasm and her leadership. Congratulations, Jocelyn. My next teacher to be recognized is Mrs. Heather Procius. She has taught in Kyrene for 15 years. Of those years, 12 have been in kindergarten classroom and the last 3 in second grade. In her spare time, she is a faculty associate teaching online courses in early childhood for ASU. I asked one of her students to tell me a funny story about Mrs. Procius, and this student, who happens to be blind, shared a story of a spelling test in which Mrs. Procius told her students not to look at each other's papers. Our little friend, who is quite the comedian, said, "I can look at anybody's because I can't see." And Mrs. Procius replied, "No, Adonis, you still are not allowed to look at other people's papers." So. Her students appreciate her for her humor and compassion. Millennio appreciates her for her dedication to students and her organizational skills. Congratulations, Heather. Thank you. Millennio's next teacher to achieve this tremendous accomplishment is Chris Huck. Chris has taught for 25 years, 16 in Casa Grande, and 9 years in Kyrene. She is greatly appreciated for her commitment to our school and taking on great challenges. She eagerly accepted the challenge of teaching our 2-3 third grade combo class and is executing this with great enthusiasm. When we interviewed her students, they wanted us to share that you, Mrs. Huck, are a great teacher because you help us learn and have a great personality. Millennio appreciates her for enthusiasm and compassion, and she also serves in a leadership role as a soccer coach for Prende. So. Congratulations, Chris. Our next teacher I wish to recognize is fourth grade teacher Greg Broberg. This is Greg's second career. He started off in the financial sector In Greg's 6 years at Millennio, he has made a significant impact on the students and the staff. Greg is a data guy, and he helps our school collect and create reports that allow us to see our students' growth and the areas of need. Greg is currently pursuing his PhD at ASU in his off time. His students share that he is very enthusiastic about his teaching, and they said when he teaches, there is a sparkle in his eye. Millennio appreciates Mr. Broberg for his tireless commitment and his pride in our school. He's also our on-site security person. So congratulations, Greg. And I have one last teacher to recognize who had a prior commitment tonight and could not be here to be recognized. Another fourth grade teacher, Amy Dean, has taught all 10 years of her career at Millennio. Amy is a leader in our school and district, serving in many organizational roles within the school and as a KA representative. Amy has a passion for reaching those students who need it most. She goes the extra mile to build relationships and a strong community of learners. Her students shared, there's a lot of special things about Ms. Dean. She's nice, outgoing. She doesn't tell you to go off and do something. She explains it. The expectations are clear. And I can tell you one thing she loves, M&Ms. Millennio appreciates her commitment to our school and every student. Congratulations to Ms. Dean.
Good evening, Madam President, members of the board, and Dr. Schauer. It is my privilege to introduce Mrs. Susan Bryant to you this evening. Susan has been teaching for 24 years, 22 in the Kyrene District and 21 at Cielo. When asked about some memorable things in her teaching career, she mentioned working with her teammates. She is part of a very collaborative grade level team, and they credit each other for making their teaching better and making teaching and learning more fun. And just to remind us all that teaching is never dull or routine, when she was teaching kindergarten at one time, she was getting the kids ready for their morning meeting, and the kids started screaming. Well, there was a backpack moving across the floor. A child had found a stray cat on the way to school, loaded him up in his backpack, and brought him on in. So congratulations to Susan.
I have to interrupt for a second, but I've known Sue, I don't know, a lot of years. In fact, she was the teacher of my grandson that has Downs when he was in second grade. Yeah, and I attest she is an excellent teacher, and her children are beautiful and smart. So congratulations.
Good evening, Madam President, Governing Board, Dr. Schauer, and members of our community. It is my honor to recognize Marcia Middleton for her accomplishment. Marcia is amazing. She has been with us for 8 years as a teacher. She started as a second grade teacher, and she's now in our multi-age 2-3. But that is not the whole story, because she has been with us at Esperanza since 1995, when her oldest was in second grade, her youngest was in kindergarten. So as a parent, she was very involved. She was PTO president. Then she moved into working for us. She started as, I gotta make sure I get the order right, as a library technician. Then she also served as a resource aide and kindergarten aide and continued that work as a kindergarten aide. Then she was a student teacher and then became a teacher. So she wears many hats. She wears them all very well. She is multi-talented. She is the one that we go to when things break, so she can take it apart and fix it. So we always say, Marcia, 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 where are you? Because we need her assistance. And she is, I want to say, the mom for all of us, because she is the first one to take care of any of us who need that warm smile, hug, support, and she's always there to take care of us. So we just adore her, and we're so happy that she is a member of our Esperanza family and hope she always will be, and congratulations.
Madam President, Governing Board and Dr. Schauer, it's my privilege to introduce Emily Mazur. Emily has been at Cerritos now for 6 years. Five of them were in kindergarten. One was in kindergarten and the rest have been in second grade. Emily has an awful lot to bring to our school. She's on countless committees and mostly areas that really count for kids upon their character and how she can make a difference in their lives. We were asked to think of one thing notable about the person that you're introducing, and with Emily, I really know that she makes great relationships with her families and with the children. We'll have parents that just write an email to me, a letter to me, just to let me know that they haven't had a better experience. Their kids really connect to her. She actually stays very close to families, even after they're out of her classroom, and she checks in on the kids and really cares about them. So it's something that I know parents feel and understand and know that she sees their kids as whole, the whole child. It's not just about academics, but she recognizes every part about them. There's something else really notable about Emily. In about 3 weeks, she'll have something really exciting to present to all of us. So congratulations both ways, Emily.
Well, good evening, Madam President, members of the board, Dr. Schauer, our leadership team, and our community. It is with great pride that I introduce Tanya Muse as one of our newest National Board Certified Teachers. I have had the privilege of knowing Tanya for many years as we worked together in Summer Academy, and then became fortunate enough to work with her this year at Kalina, where Tanya has been for the past 6 years. She has been teaching for 7 years, her first year in Casa Grande, and then the rest over at Cerritos. This year, Tanya is teaching third grade and is our gifted cluster teacher. Does an amazing job differentiating for all of the children in her class, but she goes well above and beyond the children in her class and really strives to honor the diversity and all of the cultural diversity in our school as a member of our equity team at our school. I so appreciate Tanya's commitment to not only working on the child's academic progress, but that whole child, and also all the things that she does to plan opportunities to honor that diversity, not just with our children, but with our staff and with our greater community. And so I am just so proud to recognize Tanya tonight, and congratulations.
Thank you very much for allowing us to present our nationally board certified teachers to you this evening, and congratulations to all of you. Thank you.
I would like to say thank you very much.
Go ahead.
Board certification is a grueling process. I don't know how to put it any other way. It's expensive. It's just time and effort that has to go into it. I just can't say enough for all the teachers that participated in the National Board Certification. And I think I'd like to thank Career Ladder also for helping.
Do any other board members have comments? I want to thank all the principals for sharing and introducing the teachers. Thank you to all the teachers for being here tonight. I know you're missing the State of the Union address, so a special thank you for being here tonight. And it's great that we could hear some of the stories. And so thank you for sharing, and congratulations. Dr. Schauer, did you have anything to add? We will move on to item 6.03, budget update. Dr. Schauer.
Thank you. This evening, we chose to talk about our capital outlay program and plans for that. And as you know, in our meetings, we continue to feature different budget strategies, and so this is one of them. And it occurred to me that as I was looking at this presentation and thinking about the topic, that As I look at area school districts and the information that they present on budgets, I rarely see this level of detail presented publicly. So I think this is something that we should recognize that Kyrene does that really is above and beyond, and a good thing for all of us in the community to understand what this is really all about. So Jeremy is here tonight to present some information about this, and welcome.
Good evening, Madam President, Dr. Schauer, members of the board, staff, and community. It's a tough act to follow, but we'll go ahead and transition into budget talks again. Our budget update tonight is focusing on one of our strategies for 2012-13 and how we will balance the budget. And you'll see we'll keep updating our budget balancing strategies as we present them through study sessions and board meetings. And so earlier tonight, we got to discuss custodial services during study session, and at this point, highlighted is the capital outlay revenue limit transfer that we'll discuss now. First, let's talk about what the capital outlay revenue limit is. It's used for capital purchases. That's what it's designed for. And we get $225.76 per average daily membership, so that's basically per student. However, it's been subject to legislative cuts over the past couple of years. Now, with capital outlay revenue, each year as we get our allocation, the district decides how much of that to place into maintenance and operations, which would be used for salaries, or how much of it to keep in capital to be used for capital purchases. So why do we propose moving it towards maintenance and operations? Basically because of the strong local support that we have here in our community. We have a capital override and we have bond funds that are available, both recently approved over the past couple of years. And that's what gives us the flexibilities over the past several years to transfer the funds into maintenance and operations. So right here, we're gonna look at a little bit of history. And what you'll see going back to 2009 is that we've typically put the vast majority of our capital outlay revenue limit into maintenance and operations. Now that trend changed a little bit as we entered the 2010-11 school year, and the reason for that was that we had a pending capital override that was on the ballot. And without being certain of what the outcome would be for that override, we had to start putting some funds into capital in preparation of if the override failed. You'll see we took that even higher in the 2012 year, but then once the capital override did pass, then we did move the $560,000 over to maintenance and operations, which was used for our one-time compensation adjustment. What we are proposing for this upcoming 2012-13 year is for $2 million to be placed in the maintenance and operations and the remainder to be placed in capital. Now, I realize $2 million is higher than the $1 million we just looked at, so I'll explain that. In our original projection that was used to project out our deficit for this upcoming school year, the assumption was in there that we would be comfortable with at least moving $1 million of the capital outlay into maintenance and operations. The budget balancing strategy is asking that we be comfortable with moving an additional $1 million into maintenance and operations for the total of the $2 million that we'll put into maintenance and operations. Now, what you'll see is when you compare this to years 2009 and 2010 is this is somewhat proportional to what we did in those years. What you'll also see on the bottom portion of this slide is the balance history. And you'll see that in capital outlay, we have been building that balance. So even when we were only putting a small portion of the capital outlay in capital, we were building the balance. And the reason being, again, because we had the override and the bond to rely on for our capital needs. Aside from that, I'll open up for any questions you may have.
Thanks, Jeremy. Just a couple of questions. Can you just explain just kind of briefly the interaction between CORAL and the bond and the capital override? And I guess presumably if you're in a district that does not have a bond or a capital override, this is basically how you deal with capital expenditures.
Yes, if we were in a district that didn't have the local support that we do have, we would be relying on CORAL to supply our capital needs. Additionally, There's school facilities board. However, the school facilities board has been underfunded for a number of years. But luckily, we do have the bond and override available.
So the $3 million, assuming that we proceed with this plan, the $3,023,000 and $3,023,058, or however you would say that number, where does that go? I mean, is that trapped in there for capital use, or is that purely restricted to capital expenditures, or can that be used for other purposes as well?
Normally, it'd be restricted to capital expenditures. However, over the past couple of years, the legislature has opened up laws that would allow capital, unrestricted capital or soft capital, to be used for any purpose, such as a maintenance and operations purpose. So there's flexibility right now, but that's been passed in session law, so that's not going to be a permanent change. As we go to the future and the economy recovers, it will be, once again, only used for capital purchases.
So I think that begs the obvious question, or maybe it's not so obvious. Why are we limiting the suggested use to M&O to $2 million? Why isn't it $2,721,000?
And we could consider taking that higher at the $2 million level. Again, we started with the $1 million was the assumption in the projection. We're bringing forward another million, and we could entertain the idea of transferring the entire capital outlay into maintenance and operations in the upcoming year. The only reason that I would see for hesitating to present that now would be based on the legislative changes that we're assuming are going to go into place for our bond that's being introduced currently downtown.
Right, and I don't think we're trying to make any decisions on this tonight, but you know, given that the capital override was passed, given that we have high hopes for the appropriate legislative action relative to bonding capacity, it would seem to me that this could be the home for some fun that maybe we weren't anticipating when we didn't know how the override would go and still have some doubt about how the bonding legislation is going to go, but this would seem to be the home for maybe some additional flexibility.
Yes.
At the appropriate time.
Yes.
Right. Thank you.
Yeah, I was going to ask you the same thing. Why we were just doing $2 million when, in 2008, and we still have 721 in the capital, but like 2008 and 2009, we had 350,000 basically. I'm wondering why we don't even just leave it at that amount and put another 400,000 in the M&O, and then that could basically. We could take middle school off of even this list here and just move more, you know, 500,000 or at least 400,000 back and just keep the 350 like we had done back before. I was going to ask the same question.
Yes, as we gauge where the support is for moving the transfer, we can look at increasing it anywhere up to the 100% of what we receive this upcoming year for the capital outlay.
And my only caution would be that there hasn't been anything introduced yet, correct, as far as the legislative language for the bond limit. So you expect that to happen, and we would just want to make sure that, because otherwise we have no cushion. You know, if we did have a large capital expense for some emergency or something happened, and you didn't have bond money, and you used up, you know, a large portion of this, where what would we use?
That's correct. I've seen the bills in their draft form.
Okay.
I can't say I've had enough time to follow as closely their work downtown as I typically do this year, but I know it's coming forward. There's actually two different versions that are being pursued. One is a technical corrections to last year's Senate Bill 1263, whereas another is introducing a different bill. But I've seen the options. I can't state whether or not they've been formally presented downtown yet or not.
And I don't know if this is worth your time or not, but it may be helpful to forward some positive points about that, supporting that to our legislators, for example, that were here last night. That would have been a good question to ask them if they would support that or were supporting that. But it just may be helpful for them moving it along or supporting it or something.
So, Jeremy, does the $2,721,000 include the override?
No.
It does not include the override.
No, this is just the capital outlay revenue limit allocation. For our override, we currently receive $6.8 million a year.
Right, so
we wouldn't be able to move over override funds. Those are still designated.
I understand that, but I think it was more to Michelle's point about the cushion. This is not the extent of our capital expenditure cushion. We've got the override dollars that
we
now
do.
I realize that's all for technology, but
yes, the override is available, but that's for certain capital purchases. It wouldn't be able to cover us for all capital purchases.
I see. So this is really the only cushion that we do have relative
for
to things that break.
Yes.
Very well.
Well, okay, so we're looking back from 2008, 2009. What do we, and I know that we increased a lot because of the override coming up. We weren't sure. But before that, is it normally at the 300,000 level, or where is it normal? Is that, like, if I went back to 2005, would be about 3, or would it be up to 700? Because if we're normally at the 350 or 300,000 area, I'm just wondering why
yes,
we didn't.
Yes, the 350,000 is typical. However, we also typically have access to bond funds. As of right now, if no legislation was passed, which we have significant confidence that the legislation is going to be passed, but in the event that it wasn't, we would not have any more access to bond funds. We will nearly exhaust all of our bond funds at the end of this year. And since we are currently over the limitation, we wouldn't be able to sell bonds, even though our voters approved the sale of another bond back in 2010. So in the event that the legislation didn't pass, this would be our only cushion. But again, we have significant confidence that it will.
And my only comment was just so that we're prudent in that we don't maybe vote to support this before we know what that, you know, that passes in the legislature.
Right. I would add that, you know, the timing of this is such that we have, you know, months ahead where this can be discussed and decisions can be made based on, you know, more information coming in. So that's our intent, is for you to help us shape what this ends up looking like, you know, but we have a lot of time left to do that work, so.
Right, and I don't necessarily want to fall in love with my own ideas, though they are, though they are so easy to fall in love with. But, you know, it's interesting that, you know, we had a conversation about ADK that everyone will recall and fondly remember, where we were looking for $800,000. And I'm not saying, again, that that's something that we would do or should do or even could do, but, you know, there's $721,000 that lives here or that could be looked at, you know. I mean, I realize that it's a pretty far-fetched idea in these kind of economic times, but the idea that we could actually improve on something that we do instead of detracting from something we do would be kind of an interesting concept for us to work on.
Jeremy, the next time this is presented, could you have a list of pros and cons of rolling the $721,000 into M&O, and that way we can see the pluses and minuses?
Yes, and the next time we bring this forward, we will hopefully have that language in bond. I believe they're trying to wrap up downtown in April. Mm-hmm. It's election year, so they want to get out of there soon, which means we should see that legislation soon. And at that point, there really wouldn't be many cons against moving the entire capital right. outlay into maintenance and operations.
Well, it would seem like the only con would be that if some dramatically horrendous things happened and the bond legislation didn't pass, then we could run out of money. But assuming that the bonding thing, that's going to move ahead or not in the time frames that we're going to have to approve a budget, you know.
Yes.
come Memorial Day, we're going to know whether or not that happened. So
yes,
seems like this is very promising indeed.
Okay,
thank you, Jeremy. Next is item 6.04. Dr. Schauer will give us a brief overview of budget information provided on the website. Dr. Schauer.
Thank you very much. I thought it would be important to feature this publicly so people knew what we were doing, what our efforts are to communicate about our budget process, and continue to update our internal staff and external community on where things are. And it occurred to me in presenting this in a committee meeting recently that many people haven't looked at this yet, so I thought, you know, we better make sure that we put it out there so people know that it's available. So we just clicked on the budget button of the website, which is very prominent, and if you scroll down, you will see that there's a diagram, really, that shows us how the budget process works. And so we've depicted that in a way I think that's pretty understandable. And we've talked about the fact that that cycle that you're seeing there with all of the different groups that meet and discuss the various budget issues meet periodically. So what you're seeing there is one representation of a cycle. And we have several cycles now that have taken place. And you see the board right in the center. So the information that we're talking with the various groups about also gets shared here in our board meetings and study sessions. And then we continue with the work throughout the course of the year. And then below this, and this is a kind of a new addition, which I really like, is an update of each group that meets and some easy talking points that cover, not really talking points, but I guess highlights of their meetings and their work. Not real detailed minutes, but we do have links to longer comprehensive reports depending on the group. But you can see the latest meeting, what happened, you can see who's involved. A new feature that was just added, and it came from our K-8 group suggestion the other night, was to put a response button right there in the updates. So any community member or staff member can go to the update from the task force committee or group and submit their own ideas. And then these go directly to the lead who is in charge of that particular group. So we know what community and staff are saying about these topics. So basically, we just wanted to show you what this is. We think it's a very useful tool, and I hope that our community will take full advantage of it, because there's no reason why people shouldn't know exactly what it is we're talking about throughout this budget process. So that's it. So we'll open it up if you have any questions or comments. Thank you.
Any questions or comments? Thank you for sharing that, Dr. Schauer. Next is item 6.05, committee updates. And we can go down the line. Bernadette, I think you're going to share about PSC.
We actually met at 9 o'clock that morning prior to the PSC meeting. And we had, we discussed with the PSC members about the middle school task force and what their process is. And really, it was just, I believe, more of an introduction, because there were no real specific data. I mean, there were some, and there were some questions. But just to really let those parents know where we're headed, what the direction is, some ideas for them to get further involved. So it was a great way to get the PSC, which is the Parent Superintendent Council. And then they just went into further discussion in the meeting. We had Sodexo show up, and there were some parents that have started at some of the different elementary schools. Bless you, Mary. some concerns and some great ideas of nutrition and what we can do and how we can partner better with Sodexo with ideas. And I think it was a great conversation. And really, that was, I think, the bulk of our PSC meeting. And I think, everyone's just on board to find out about, where middle school heads.
Thank you. And Ms. Brazell, about the Citizens Budget Committee?
It was broken down into three kind of different topics. And the first was they had presentations from the different groups for the land usage on the advertising, and Jeremy invited three companies to come, three, and only one actually did come and do a presentation, and did a pretty in-depth presentation of what they would do with the land as far as doing a big billboard. And then he was going to find out from one of the other big two whether or not they were still interested or not. And then Nancy did a quick presentation on what we're doing with preschool and trying to get that out there and trying to increase our preschool enrollment. And then the final part was kind of structure of the CBC and how they might be making some changes and maybe having a lead person go to different groups and the structure of the organization of the CBC.
Thank you. And then I attended the K-8 Programming Study Committee meeting on January 17th. And I took all these notes. I'm going to read them right now. I'm just kidding. But I will say they shared.
Good job.
Taking her sign. Jeremy and Dr. Schauer shared about the budget process. Laura Neville presented about the elementary coaches and how they're working, well, about the task force and the process that they're using to evaluate that, and I was very impressed with that presentation. The middle school task force was also presented, and I was encouraged that so many of the teachers gave input and asked questions about that, and Dr. Schauer shared some of that information that he just showed. So I think it was a really positive meeting, and the process is moving along. And for people that want more information, I believe there are the minutes online if you wanted to read even beyond all my notes. Next is the consent agenda. May I have a motion to approve tonight's consent agenda?
Move to approve tonight's consent agenda.
Second.
All in favor, please say aye.
Aye.
Aye. Motion passes 5-0. Next is item 8.01, approval of interim chief financial officer, transitioning to chief financial officer position, Dr. Schauer.
Thank you very much. We're very excited to make this announcement tonight publicly. And Jeremy Caius perhaps has been through the longest job interview process of anyone who has ever been employed with the Kyrene School District. And Jeremy joined us over a year ago. You've been here probably a year and a half now, almost 2 years. And through that time, he has served as Director of Business Services and then most recently as Interim Chief Financial Officer. And as we've moved forward with our process and really doing a national search and trying to find the very best person we could for this position, we decided that the very best person is the person who's sitting right here in front of us now. So we are excited to name Jeremy Chief Financial Officer of Kyrene. And I think his family's here and they might like to take a picture of him. Probably have to stand up.
Dave, why don't you go up there and take a picture with him?
Oh, okay. I will later. Okay. Because we'll be done in a minute.
I would move approval of item 8.01, approval of Jeremy Caius as Chief Financial Officer position.
With delight, I second.
Any further discussion? All in favor, please say aye.
Aye.
Aye. Motion passes 5-0. Item 9.01, there are no information items this evening. Item 10.01 are items for future consideration. We have several items that we're working on. You can see shortly, perhaps, the disposition of each when we're going to address those things. Sorry, I know they're not popping up, but do any board members have anything to add for items for future consideration? Mr. Rock?
Hirsch, I don't necessarily have a new item to add, but I might suggest that the use and process for the existing land get moved up a little bit from April 24th. That's something that it would seem that the board, or I'll speak for myself, I don't know what the board would like, but might want to hear something about sooner than that.
Okay. Noted. Mrs. Coggins?
And mine doesn't have a date, the transitioning from middle school into high school, but I think that's been a hot topic, so maybe we move that one up as we are getting close to registration for the different high schools, and I think it would be important.
Okay. Thank you. Next is 11.01. You can see the list of meeting dates. Our next meeting here is February 14th, Valentine's Day. I like dark chocolate, in case anybody wants to know. And item 12.01 is board reflections. Do any board members have reflections to share? Ms. Brazell.
I do.
Oh, I'm sorry, I didn't see you.
Okay.
Ellen.
I just want to thank the district for hosting last night, where our senator and two representatives showed up. I wish the answers were more positive. than they were, but it was nice opening up a dialogue.
And I wanted to second what Ms. Sharma just said. I appreciate the time of the legislators coming out and speaking with our families, and of the questions that people asked, and the present and the good response we had. And it was nice to see some families here, and I'm hoping we can maybe do it at least on a semi-annual basis.
Great. And I just wanted to highlight, if you haven't read in the paper, hopefully you know that it's No Name Calling Week, and 12 of our schools are participating in that. I want to thank the Kyrene Education Association's Human and Civil Rights Committee for making that happen. And today happens to be, each day has a little bit different theme. And today is walking a mile in someone else's shoes. And I know some of us have different shoes on today. That was one of the things, you could wear mismatched shoes. And if I was so inclined, I'd kick my feet up here and show you that I have two mismatched shoes. But I am clearly not inclined to do that at a board meeting. So I just want to thank you for making that happen, and that we're all aware of tolerance and bullying, and that we can also not just stand by and watch that happen, even if we don't happen to be a bully ourselves. And that's all for me, Dr. Schauer.
I have one quick one that Mrs. Winkleman told me about. We have three schools that are receiving A-plus visits, and this is a good sign because it means that they're in the contention for this award, and it's Brisas, Esperanza, and Altadena. Was that the third one? So congratulations. That's a huge achievement. And we hope to hear more in the future. I'm sure you do too.
And the next item on the agenda is a motion for adjournment.
Moved.
Go ahead. So moved.
Second.
All in favor, please say aye.
Aye.
Aye. Motion passes 5-0. Good night, everyone. Meeting adjourned at 7:58.